in this edition of Art Loft. A fish tail becomes a work of art.
The eye is key. Once you paint the eye in, it just brings the whole thing to life.
A muralist takes on her biggest challenge.
I like working in the privacy of my studio, and working out in the streets, you're always going to have eyes on you.
A painter whose message is front and center.
When I bring sculptural elements in, or like pieces from the land, I have a tendency to think about modes of representation.
And an animated obsession gets ironed out. It's all ahead on this edition of Art Loft.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, Newman's Own, giving all profit to charity and pursuing the common good for over 30 years, Alva H. and Wyline P. Chapman Foundation, and
in the Florida Keys in Key West, every night is a spectacular show, and every day is another masterpiece.
Hi, I'm Kalyn James, and from Gallery 212, Wynwood Art Group, this is Art Loft. This week, we take a look at obsessive behavior and oversized artwork, but our first story takes us to America's southernmost city, Key West. Just off the infamous Mallory Square is the oldest art gallery in Key West, the Key West Art Center. And that's where we caught up with Kim Workman, who goes by the name Kimian and creates unusual works using a process known as Gyotaku.
My name is Kim Workman. I do Gyotaku fish rubbings, and that is a Japanese art that originated about 200 years ago, and it was a way for fishermen to record their catch. So they would catch the fish, put black ink on the fish, press white paper, and get an exact replica so they could take it back to the emperor and show him, oh, this is what I caught, and they would have actual fishing tournaments doing it that way. My late husband was a marine biologist, and he did it for scientific study in college, and I've always painted. And he said, you should do Gyotaku, or fish rubbings. I had no idea what that was, but once he introduced me to it, I started to add a lot of color to the rubbings, which normally you don't. It's traditionally done black ink, white rice paper. And just from there, it's just grown. You know, I've been doing it for 17 years, I guess, now. I'm pretty much self-taught, although I had never used watercolor. I liked it, and you know, it just worked well for me. So basically, I just did whatever I thought I liked, the colors. The one back here is was printed in Nova Scotia. It was a 7-pound lobster. So I traveled there and bought it from the fish market. So they steamed it, took it back and printed it, and then ate it for 3 days. It's like huge. Everything I print, I try to eat, of course, except for the bait. That just goes back to be used as bait again. But yes, a lot of people catch their own fish and they'll call me and say, oh, can you print this instead of having it mounted? So people will call me and I'll print the fish and then I'll actually fillet it for them most of the time and return it to them, you know, so they get to eat it and then they get a nice print of their fish. It starts off with the black ink, as you saw, and then I paint the background that it's going to be on. And this was white. If I have the paper already colored, then I will print the black ink onto the colored paper. So it's, most people think it's done in reverse, but it's not. So colored paper, then the black ink process, then I paint over the black ink onto the colored paper. Some of these are collaged, where I actually do the print like this on the white paper, paint the fish, tear it out, then apply it onto the other paper. The one you see up here is actually on metal. I had in my mind I was wanted the fish to be like swimming like a wave, so that's metal and it's mounted on wood. And then I take the paper, I adhere it with wheat paste to the prepared metal, then adhere the fish over the metal on top of that, and that's how I get that effect. And the eye is key. Once you paint the eye in, it just brings the whole thing to life. And whether you color the fish in or not, just that eye, you know, it does it. And then when you put a little frame on it, you have a beautiful little piece of art, you know. Octopus is really hard. I've done several octopus, but there's no way to get them flat. you know, the body, and there's a lot of tentacles, and I will do it again, but that's one of the more difficult ones to print, for me anyway. Somebody said my art looks like diving on acid.
You can learn more about Kim Workman and her art by visiting her website at kimiansart.com and get some tips on how to create your own fish rubbings. And if you'd like to learn more about the Key West Art Center, they can be found at keywestartcenter.com. The website includes information about upcoming events at the center, so check it out.
If I just made beautiful paintings, what I'm trying to get at within the work would be lost.
Our next story is a profile of a prolific young Miami artist. Tatiana Suarez has been creating unusual works of art featuring her trademark dreamy doe-eyed girls. The size and scope of her recent work has ranged from adorning footwear to massive murals.
My name's Tatiana Suarez, a Miami-born artist who just relocated from Brooklyn back to Miami. My mom's Brazilian, my dad's side of the family is from El Salvador. I was born in Miami. Lately, a lot of my work has been inspired by my cultural background, especially the Brazilian side, because that's the side I'm more familiar with. A lot of my work is influenced by folklore or legends and myths told from like Brazilian history. I'm also really inspired by the indigenous people of Brazil, the Amazon forest, primarily their names and the meanings of their names. A name's enough to inspire a whole piece, just the definition of what the name is. When I first started painting these women, I was heavily influenced by cartoons, primarily Disney, Tim Burton, animation, stuff like that. I think that's where the birth of the big eyes came from. And then as I've been working and kind of discovering myself more, I've been more open to the idea of where I come from. And it's been a big part of my paintings for the last couple of years. No special training, just always took art in school and never went to an art school or anything like that. And then I slowed that down to study graphic design in college. And it wasn't until my senior year that I started dabbling again into the painting, and I liked it. So after working in advertising for a year, I just kind of saved up enough money to quit and just focus on my artwork. I think the largest mural I've done was probably the one I did this weekend. I don't know the size exactly, but it was probably around 13 feet tall. That's kind of new. I mean, I did my first mural in 2009, and it's been interesting and different for me, but I like taking my girls outdoors since nature is a big part of my work. And I'm still trying to figure out my technique and method when it comes to painting the girls outside such large scale. It's still something I'm not too comfortable with. I like working in the privacy of my studio, and working out in the streets, you're always going to have eyes on you. Especially if it's Basel, there's just crowds and people want to talk to you and take pictures, and I don't like people seeing the beginning processes of my work. It's also so large scale and usually very hot, so paint dries quicker and it's hard to get an idea, like the overall look of the thing. You always have to keep stepping back, which becomes a problem if you're on a 12-foot ladder, keep going up, draw an eye, come back down, walk. It's just, but it's rewarding at the end. I recently did a collaboration with Reebok City Classics. I was chosen to represent Miami. I did a painting that they were able to put onto a shoe. I know that sounds cliche, but I'll pull inspiration out of anywhere, especially if you're working for theme shows. That usually helps. I mean, most of these things were for theme shows. Like, I have a zombie piece, so that's why she's a zombie. My first show was in Wynwood. It was with Anti-Culture. And then right after that, I kind of moved, so I really haven't had the opportunity to exhibit in Miami, really. Just Basel, that's it. Yes, I'll be painting the largest mural I've ever done so far. It's gonna be about 112 feet long, or like 15 feet high, and then 30 feet at one point. Well, it's gonna be just me. It's not gonna be a collaboration with other graffiti artists, but I'm definitely gonna have to get some help from my friends to just fill in, at least, like the characters. It's gonna be seven girls, which is, I always draw like a single girl, if anything, too, but it's gonna be a lot of work. They're gonna be mermaids. That's just, I guess, a lot of my work has been, I guess living in New York, I've just been homesick. So I thought it would be appropriate to paint a mural in downtown Hollywood that was inspired by the ocean. I work primarily in oil, but the spray cans are more for the murals. I'm getting comfortable with that. I started murals with just house paint and acrylic, but the spray paint is easier, like it's less time to fill in. Well, my dad used to draw a lot and paint a lot when he was younger, and he's kind of stopped. He sketches, but that was a big influence growing up, having that around, and he really liked, his work was very surreal, and he was really into Salvador Dali. So all that's, like, I was raised with that around me and was surrounded. So all of that played a big part growing up, but it was mostly Disney. I used to always get How to Draw, The Little Mermaid, The Lion King books. So I used to always love drawing animals. I actually drew a lot of animals before I started painting like actual women. I've been having so many shows and group shows the past couple years that after this next show I have coming up in October, I kind of want to take a little break to focus on, you know, experimenting with my work and trying to grow as an artist, because I don't have time when there's deadline after deadline. But I don't know, I just like to focus more on my technique and improve it. And I don't know, it's always a surprise to see where I'll be in the next couple of years.
This U of M graduate recently returned to her hometown of Miami, and we expect to see more of her work in the near future, including one of her annual Basel murals. If you want to see more of her work, visit her website at tatisuarez.com. Gregory Euclid is not an average landscape painter. In a stunning show of flying pencils and scraping spatulas, he brings his painting to life, and his intuitive attack on the canvas is almost as breathtaking as the finished piece. Take a look.
Well, as a young artist, I started just drawing mostly because that's how you could get attention. And like any psychologist will tell you, if you get attention from doing something, you'll continue to do it. This is where I get my material. Every time it rains, you can find, this is some kind of styrofoam. You'll find it all over here. Time's a software for mouth to dress. Breaking all the rules. I'm going down, down for you. If someone hasn't seen my work before, I tend to describe it as landscape painting, maybe contemporary landscape painting. So what I'll do is pick it all up and put it in my pocket and bring it back. Whenever I try to explain it to someone, it ends up getting very long-winded and very confusing, and they usually just end, I usually just end up saying, that's landscape painting. It's gotta keep raining, otherwise I'll run out of supplies. Well, I use the styrofoam in my work to kind of symbolize this thing that's man-made but omnipresent in the landscape. So it's not very difficult to find this stuff everywhere you go. So sometimes I'll use the spatula to scrape the paint across the surface and let the paint kind of act as paint and not appear so representational. I also like the way that it kind of scumbles along the surface. You were born into a strange world. Like a candle, you were meant to share the fire. I don't know where we come from, I don't know where we go. But my arms are made to hold you, so I will never let you go. Because you were born. So there's land here, and in the center of this scene, I'm going to create some type of industry that moves in and kind of starts, is built upon that land. The stuff that's around this is going to be more deliberate and organized because it's a city. So city planning is much different than, you know, a natural prairie or a forest. I think of it as experience and memory. So when I go out into a forest, I walk through the forest and I'm experiencing these vignettes moment by moment. And by vignettes, I mean there's maybe you walk down a hill and you remember that moment of walking down the hill, or you come across a pond and then you remember seeing that or spending the time there, and then you move on to a new place. And you start to think about the ecosystem in general. It's just, it's overwhelming. It's impossible for one person to understand what's even going on in 1 foot of space in the forest. And that complexity and that density has always been a part of my work. To chase the light, 'cause you were born. It's like, you think that's just a city? Well, no, it's there used to be oak savanna there. And before the oak savanna, it used to be hunted by, you know, Dakota and Sioux. And before that, it's like the history of spaces we often forget about. This is nature, like dead nature, and then culture. So you've got coffee cups, styrofoam. It's like, this is the perfect blending pot right here. This is like reality, what exists. I've got this type of framework established here, and the water works great because I can go and erase things. So like this area right here, if I spray that up close, you can see that like any paint that was still wet will start to fall away. And you get this pattern of decay, and then having that actually happen on the surface of the painting always seemed interesting. In order to hold them, they need to dry like that. Think about what's represented two-dimensionally, and sometimes try to create a complement to it three-dimensionally. This all started by, I made some paintings that had two or three sheets of paper on, and I would go through and I would rip through them, and then I'd start painting the next scene onto that, as though it's like a moment in time, and then you pass through the threshold of that moment into the next stage. The paint that dripped down would pool up inside of these like relief areas. I thought, okay, well, that relief area then becomes a lake. Well, what's going to happen around a lake? You're going to get, there's water there, so you're going to have growth up around the lake. So it seemed like a rich place to kind of start putting the relief elements in, just having them, you know, stand there like that, because they can't. Because the paper comes out in relief, then the objects can use that as a foothold to start. It's like on a side of a cliff, any rock that comes out, there's going to be something that's growing on there, whereas on the cliff face, it's much more rare. When I bring sculptural elements in, or like pieces from the land, I have a tendency to think about modes of representation. You have an illusionistic space that's painted where people can go in with their mind. You have a space that actually comes out that people can move around with their body. And then you have these like fake kind of model type materials that are produced on there. Trees that I make from sedum, or like, you know, the architectural type of things. So I started fooling around with various plastic bags. The idea that you can take and make a form that looks like something natural out of something that's, you know, petroleum-based and completely destructive, and have that in this landscape, that's kind of important, because the landscape itself seems very picturesque, but, you know, these are the things that we use on a daily basis that are the antithesis to this kind of idea. All of these different modes of representation get introduced into the sculptural mix, and it's kind of left to the viewer to negotiate how those things blend together. And if I just made beautiful paintings, what I'm trying to get at within the work would be lost. You know, so if I can introduce as much garbage as possible from the land into the work, that kind of reflects on the state of land today, as well as making the painting a little bit more realistic to me. I want it to feel like I'm present in the land in general, you know, and it contains all of the thoughts that I have. I think that's how I want to just keep making it more and more realistic in that sense. When I look at a landscape painting, I think that's like 1/12 of the story.
Gregory Euclid recently wrapped up shows in Minneapolis, Miami, and New York. His art is also featured on the covers of several Bon Iver albums. To find out more, visit gregoryeuclid.com.
This cleans up all the inside and outside cuts, any little burrs that might have been left, any rough edges. It kind of smooths out the rough edges on it. Really takes it from a rough piece of metal to almost a finished piece of metal.
Our last story today comes from the MIA Animation Conference. Obsessive is the story of a girl dealing with her pretty obsession. It was directed by Turkish animator Denise Okal and showcases her wonderfully unique and mature style. Let's take a look. If you enjoyed this film and other animation we've been presenting, be sure to visit the MIA Animation website. The conference is coming to Miami again in October, and registration information is available on their website at miaanimation.com. And that wraps it up for this edition of Art Loft. Until next time, I'm Kalyn James reminding you to stay creative. Thanks for watching.
I see, right? She looks a lot like me with the braids. We can...
get away with it. That's nice. You guys are fine. You can stand anywhere over there. Okay. That's a great ball. I'll practice Ollie sand. You must have held your hand on the turtle, because that's not at all the speed. Isn't that funny? I'm hot. You're sweating too. You're shining. Oh, I've got some powder. How's my nose? It feels like it's wet.
I'm so sorry.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation. Newman's Own, giving all profit to charity and pursuing the common good for over 30 years. Alva H. and Wyline P. Chapman Foundation. And
in the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.